Dear professional colleagues, a warm good evening to one and all. I welcome you all for the first study circle meeting for my term. As you all are aware that we had a branch election on 13th February 2016 for the term 2016-19. I am very much happy to inform you that I got elected and became the chairman of Bangalore branch. With all your support extended to me, and the same way I seek your support for the entire team. Now I want to introduce my entire team to all the Swagat gathering, and now I call our all committee members. Vice Chairman has been elected by Peeta. Just Secretary Shabat.
Thanks a lot for all your support.
And Treasurer by Shivram Bhatt. Sikasa Chairman Pore. And the past President of KC also. And we four existing committee member has been elected, and again they taken under the convention we have elevated to one position high. And we have Sikasa co-opted members, Srinivas T and also Divya S. And we have one more committee member, BT Shetty, where we have made an responsible for event coordination, BT Shetty. And I congratulate all our new team, and also members to congratulate all our new team. Thank you. Yeah, we have decided the theme for the year, Pragati, which is originated from Sanskrit word, and it is a very common word in the many languages. In all the languages, the word Pragati translates to progress or improvement. It also stands for moving in a positive direction. Cross stands for positive and Gati stands for movement. Therefore, we have moved towards a positive direction. Theme for the year, Pragati stimulates moving in a positive direction. Here, the tagline we have selected, serve to grow and grow to serve. Growth is signified by the growing tree, the tree of knowledge, and knowledge is powered by the pen. That's what which we are finding in the logo. The growth has been achieved by service to the profession, therefore serve to grow, and growth has been achieved to sustain the continuous service to the profession. Hence we have selected the logo, Pragati. And now, without wasting much of time, I want to give it to the speaker, and we have a very eminent and expert speaker on the subject, and welcome him for this first study circle meeting of my tenure. With me, we are interested to come and yes. And now I request our committee member B.T. Shetty to formally welcome Mr. Togal Bote. And the whole action plan of the year will be discussed in the next sessions. And now I end the session proceedings to the set of seven secretary to introduce the speaker.
A beautiful evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed my pleasure to introduce the technical session speaker of the first study circle meeting that is being held under the Managing Committee for the term 2016-19. The speaker is R Venkatesh, who comes from a commerce background. He is a commerce graduate from Mysore University and a law graduate from Bangalore University. He did his articleship in MSSB & Co., where later on he went on to become the partner, and he is serving as a partner in the firm presently. R Venkatesh is a tax consultant for many leading cooperative banks in Karnataka. He is an expert in several fields like bank audits, taxation of cooperative banks, taxation of non-profit institutions, TDS, tax audit, survey, search and seizure. He was the president of Karnataka State Chartered Accountants Association in the year 98-99. He was the vice chairman of All India Federation of Tax Practitioners South Zone. He is a resource person for programs organized by the branches of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. include NKSCAA, All India Federation of Tax Practitioners, and also other professional associations. He has addressed teleconference at New Delhi on TDS as well. He is the resource person for management development program that is conducted by ICAI for the executives of public sector undertakings. He has given more than 100 lectures on TDS, taxation of cooperative banks and cooperative societies, survey, search and seizure in different parts of the country. With this brief introduction, I welcome the session speaker once again and over to you, sir.
Good evening, friends. First, I want to congratulate the new team who are taken out in the morning, especially the chairman of the branch, Pampanna, vice chairperson, Geeta, and secretary servant, and the Sikasa chairman, Mr. Kore, and the treasurer Bhatt, and other office bearers of this. I wish this team is going to be a very grand success in all way. I know because they have already planned a lot of programs for the year. I think we will have a very successful year. With this, friends, actually Pampanna's previous, before he became chairman also, he invited me. Sir, you should be the first resource person for my program. Friends, I agreed in the month of January itself. I told, okay, whenever you fix, I am very pleasure to address the first meeting of your team. Accordingly, organized today meeting. Friends, all you aware, the TDS is not a new chapter or a new section which you are dealing day and day in your practice. But a lot of issues we are facing day by day. But I want to deal today. Latest issues are amendments in the Finance Act 2015 or 14, which relate to the assessment year 13-14, which you are now facing before the assessing officer. And next is some of the issues raised and some of the circular issued by the CBDT, which are latest, which I am going to discuss. And some of the issues are raised to understand some of the topics of the TDS, critical issues. This is the topic, friends, for the day. Before going to the topic in particular, first, friends, you see that from 1985 onwards, you take a profit loss account or income expenditure account, debit side of the profit loss account, all the expenditure you see, all covered by TDS projects. You take anything, salary, TDS project covered, job works, professional charges, anything you take is covered by the TDS projects. Friends, actually, Chapter 73 deals with these TDS provisions. We have 42 sections, around 33 rules dealing with these TDS provisions. Come to collection, 40% of the direct tax collections comes by our TDS. It means current year, expected by our finance ministry, around 7 lakh odd crores from direct taxes, out of which 40% comes to your 3 lakh crores is from the TDS. We have to wait and see whether they are going to achieve the target. Otherwise, we, our assessors are going to face a lot of problems with this survey and the other issues. Anyway, but you come to the TDS administration side, I think you already know. In Bangalore, we have a TDS commissioner. There is already a proposed group with the finance ministry. They want to have a major metropolitan city. They want to have a chief commissioner of income tax TDS. Under him, there will be three commissioners. One may be assigned the TDS salary, another will be rent, another will be other than rent and salary. This is going to be the administrative target, administrative setup they are going to set up in respect of the TDS administration. Anyhow, Karnataka, especially Bangalore range, I think they have achieved last year target more or less, so small deficit. This year they are expecting, they are not in a position to achieve target because of various reasons. Now, with this background, friends, we'll discuss TDS issues. In that, my presentation or my discussion will be, first I will discuss basics. It means you should know concepts before dealing with chapter 17. You should know, as a deductor or a deductee, you should know what are the basic concepts. Then I'll take a few sections which are amended in the Finance Act 2015, which is of greater importance. I will discuss some of the 4-5 sections. Then I'm going to discuss circulars and notification, which are relevant. And I'm going to the critical issues, where I am raising a lot of issues. I am expecting your reaction on the all the critical issues. This is the my way of presentation. Friends, first is, as an advisor, as a consultant, you should know whom you are advising. Whether you are advising to deduct R or whether you are advising to deduct P. First thing you should ask, always know what happens over the phone, somebody will be saying that, what is the TDS rate under 194C? You'll say 1%, 2%. Without asking, what is the nature, what is the expense, whether it comes under 194C, simply over the phone. Friends, don't give any reaction to the clients or anybody ask questions on TDS unless you satisfy all basic requirements. Number one, you should know the status of a deductor. Under Chapter 17B, any person means individual, NGO, partnership firm, company, UOP, everybody is covered. Peculiar of this Chapter 17B is, any person means he is not necessarily a taxpayer. He can, even though he is not liable for income tax, still he has to comply with the Chapter 17B. Take for example, an agriculturist. He is a purely an agriculturist. He is not having any central income, but he is not liable for any tax return filing. But he is paying a salary to his manager, suppose 50,000 rupees per month. Then you have to comply with the chapter section 182, you have to deduct tax source and file the return, whatever the record. It means that you should not be under the impression the TDS provisions are applicable only to taxpayers. It is wrong. It is applicable to any person. Next is agriculturist. Next is charitable education. Maybe income of the charitable institution or education institution 100% exempted subject to some conditions, but still they have to comply with the Chapter 17B, our requirement of deducting tax source, remitting to the government, all other requirements they have to do. Therefore, first thing is, as a consultant, you should know any person TDS provisions are applicable. For that, any person, specifically individual HO, is applicable provided they fulfill these following conditions. Number condition is, for individual HO, when you ask your client asks over the phone, if he is an individual, you have to ask, oh, you are an individual, yes. For which year you want to know view, whether for a current financial year, then you have to ask, what is the turnover for the year ending 31st March 2015. These are the, you have to ask questions. You should not give your views without knowing the fundamental basics. One is, whose total sales are a gross asset or a turnover exceed the monetary limit specified under section 44AB of the Act, section 44A or B. It means more than 100 lakhs or more than 25 lakhs in case of profession, then it is this TDS process are applicable only during the financial year immediately preceding financial year. Example, for the year ending 31st March 2015, the person who has asked a question is a businessman, his turnover is 125 lakhs. Then he is asking a question for the current financial year 15-16, for the year ending 31st March 2015, his turnover is more than 125 lakh. For the current financial year, he is asking a question whether I am liable to deduct tax source. Your question is yes, you are liable to deduct because immediately preceding previous year, your turnover is more than the limit discrimination of 44AB. Even though turnover for the current year may be less than the limit prescribed under 44AB. Take for example, for the year ending 31st March 2015, 125 lakhs. For the current year, my expected turnover is only 60 lakhs. Still, TDS provisions are applicable for the current financial year. It means for criteria decided to an individual or HO for level for TDS, immediate preceding previous year turnover is very important. You should ask question when your question raised by the person is an individual or HO status. You have to ask him what is the turnover for the year ending 31st March 2015. His question is related to financial year 15-16, then you have to answer. It means that for individual HF, TDS is applicable provided if their turnover or if the businessman turnover or professional, if it exceeds the limit prescribed in 44AB for the immediate preceding previous, then the subsequent current year is liable to deduct tax. So, you are clear, sir? Then,
sir. Suppose the turnover current is 60 lakhs. Based on last year turnovers more than 1 crore, it is applicable this year.
Okay, that's what I told.
Next year
it is not applicable. Sir, each year is independent year. You have to see what is the immediate preceding previous turnover? You have to ask question. He says more than 100 lakhs in case of business. Profession is more than 25 lakhs. Then for the current financial year, TDS is applicable even though the turnover is less than the limit prescribed. Next year, it is not applicable. Therefore, your answer to an individual or HF deductor based on the previous year's turnover or gross asset. That is the point you have to keep in mind. Next is, but this question, in case of a salary, this is no question. If an individual is paying the salary, if it is more than the limit prescribed, more than the taxable limit, then you have to deduct tax also. So this turnover or gross has no relevance at all. For 182, only for 182, there is no turnover limit. For other sections, the turnover limit is very important. Clear, sir? Then, you should know what is the status of a recipient. Person who is receiving from you, what is the status? Individual, HU, company, or partnership for EOP, what government? If the recipient is the individual or HU, rate of deduction is different. Firm is different, company is different. Take for example 194C. If a person who is receiving from you is an individual HUF, rate of TDS is 1%. If a person who is receiving from you is other than individual and HUF, rate of TDS is 2%. Then if the person is receiving from you is a government, no TDS. Under 196, very clear, state government or central government, or department of state government or department of central government, any amount paid is not subject to TDS under 196. That is the president. Next is applicable surcharge. Thanks to then Finance Minister Pranab Mukherjee, he removed all the surcharge, education cess on TDS from 1st October 2009. You have to deduct only the basic rate of TDS, no surcharge, no education cess. But if you are making a payment to a non-resident, then surcharge is applicable after a threshold limit of more than 8 crore. That is the requirement. Next is, friends, you should know, what is the status of the person who is received from you, whether he is a resident or a non-resident? If a person who is received from you is a resident, all the provisions of Chapter 17 is applicable. But if a person who is received from me is a non-resident, go to Section 195. No other sections are applicable. Straight away go to, if you are paying a rent to a non-resident, go to Section 195. No threshold limit, nothing. You have to deduct TDS at the rate what prescribed under Part 2 of the first schedule, deduct accordingly. But in the other case, a resident means, then your rent means you have to go to 184H, contract means you have to go to 194C, if it is a brokerage means you have to go to 194H. But in case of a person who is receiving from me is a non-resident, you have to go to 185 directly, no other sections. Therefore, you should clear person who is receiving from me is a resident or non-resident. After that, in the hands of the director, the expenditure may be capital expenditure, it may be revenue expenditure, or reimbursed compensations, all are subject to TDS. You should not be under the impression only revenue expenditure are subject to TDS, all other expenditure is not subject. No, even capital expenditure. Suppose you are constructing a factory building, you will be subject to TDS under 194C or 194J. If we are revenue expenditure, you know all the revenue expenditure are subject to TDS. Reimbursement expenses also subject to TDS. Reimbursement expenses also subject to TDS. I will discuss later what is happening with some issues. Next thing is, friends, all the provisions of Chapter 17B says that you have to deduct tax or so at the time of payment or credit, whichever is earlier. When you have to deduct tax TDS is at the time of payment or credit, whichever is earlier. Payment is not necessarily a check payment. Even if you make a cash payment also, you have to deduct tax or source. Check payment, you have to deduct tax or source. Or if you have credit, if you have not made a payment, you are passing an entry by crediting the part account or other liability account or current liability account or suspense account, still you have to deduct tax or source. It means deduct at the earliest point of payment or credit, whichever is earlier. Only in case of 5 transactions, you have to deduct only at time payment. Salary, only at time payment, 184BB, 184B, 184L and 184LA. All these cases you have to deduct TDS only at the time of payment, not at the credit. But all other sections you have to deduct at the time of payment or credit, whichever is earlier. Rate of deduction. You have to deduct according to the rate prescribed in the respective section. Most of the sections you can say what rate you have to deduct. 194C, 194I, 194J, all the sections prescribe what rate you have to deduct. Very clearly mentioned in section. If it is not mentioned in section, then you have to go to the part 2 to the first schedule of the relevant act. It means if you are seeing for the current year, you have to see Finance Act 2015, first schedule, Finance Act first schedule. Part 2 gives the rate at which you have to deduct tax and source. Take for example 194A or non-resident payment, you have to go to part 2 of the first schedule. In case of salary, you have to go to part 3 of the first schedule. That gives the rate at which you have to get taxes. So this is the, and I already told you, no surcharge, no education charge. Thank God to Mr. Pranam Mukherjee. You know, otherwise, earlier you have to get 1 point plus another 3%. It is a lot of decimals. Now it is only basic rate 1%, 2%, 10%. Very simple. No surcharge, no education charge. Surcharge is applicable only when you are making payment to a non-resident who is more than 1 crore. Then you have to get surcharge with a rate of 5%. Otherwise, no other cases. When to remit the taxes to the government? I think you all have to, you have to remit on or before 7th or subsequent month. But to be clear, first 11 month is, that is the due date. First 11, April to February, you have to, what are the TDS deducted? You have to remit on or before 7th or subsequent month. It means for April to February, whatever your TDS deducted, whether deducted 1st January or 10th January or 20th January or 31st January, you have to remit on or before 7th February. That is the due date. But for the month of March, you have to remit on or before 30th April. For the month of March, last month of the year, whether it deducted 1st March or 10th March or 20th March or 31st March, including provision made for which you have not made the payment, including provision made at the year end, 31st March, you have to remit the tax to the government on 30th April. That is a 30 days time for you to remit the first. All the 11 months, you have to remit on or before 7th. This is for deductor other than government. In case of a deductor is a government, you have a other. If the government, you have an option to make the payment by using a challan, then the due date is next month 7th, including March also they have to remit before 7th April. But they have gone on to make the payment, they are using only a quick entry, same day they have to remit. A government deductor, they have to remit the taxes. If they are making a payment by a quick entry, there is no challan payment, then they have to remit the taxes to the government on the same day. No, next month 7th. On the same day they have to remit. This is the due date for government deductor. Next is returns. After deducting, after remitting, after thing, you have one more obligation as a deductor. You have to file returns, quarterly returns. All of you know 24Q for salaries. Other than salaries, 26Q. Due date is, you know, first quarter is by 15th July, second quarter by 30th September, third quarter, the 30th September by 15th October, third quarter December by 15th January, last quarter you have a time up to 15th May. Because 30th April is the last date for remitting taxes, you have a time up to 15th May to upload your quarterly return. This is the due date. After uploading, you have one more obligation. You issue a certificate to the deductees. Most of the deductors ignore this obligation. But you have to issue the certificate to the deductor, deductees. Salary 16A. Other than salary is 16A. 16 is for salary, other than salary is 16A. Due date is for form 16, certificate 16, you have to give annually. That is annually, after year it is over, all full year transaction, all four quarter together, you have to give the certificate by 31st May of the financial year. Means you have a 2 months time for after end of the year, you have to give the certificate. In case of a 16A, other than salary, you have to give on a quarterly basis. After uploading by 15th July, by 30th July you have to give the certificate to the deductees. It means you have within 30 days from the end of the quarter you have to give the certificate to the deductees. That is in case of other than salaries, is 16A you have to give. If you are not given, there is also penalty prescribed at 272, 100 rupees per day of default. 100 rupees is the fine for not issuing the certificate within the time. Now I talked general basics, we will come to the some of the issues on the particular section. Section 182 salary, you know, it will be charged up to the salaries. You have to deduct at the payment, average rate of income tax. It means you have to estimate the income of the employee for full year in the beginning of the year. It means in the month of April itself, you have to estimate what is the salary you are going to pay, including estimated bonus, including estimated incentive, you have to work out. And find out what is the tax liability. If tax liability comes to 10,000 rupees, every month you are supposed to deduct 1,000 rupees and submit to the government. Most of the employers will not do first few months. That is the usually, I have seen, first 6 months they will ignore this 192. Only they start calculating only the last. If they start with 6 months, it is very good. Otherwise, they will start in the last quarter of the year. They think that, okay, 192, calculate. But it is not correct. You are supposed to calculate at the beginning of the year. And what are the tax liability, you have to calculate average income tax deduct every month. That is the requirement. Whether you have to consider chapter 16 reduction, yes, you can consider it. As per Dhani Sarkar, you can consider all the chapter 16 reductions, no problem. But now, in the current financial year, the section 192, there is a new provision introduced in 2D, effective from 1st June 2015. Friends, up to 31st May or earlier year, we have a practice or is followed in the earlier year, you have to take the chapter 16 deduction based on the declaration given by the employer. Usually say, I am going to invest in ADC 150,000, I am going to invest in medical client 15,000, 20,000, I am house property, interest payment, so much. A letter from the employee, it is enough for the deductor to consider and allow the deduction. Chapter 16 deduction or last month the house property. Friends, from 1st June 2015, through Finance Act 2015, they introduced a new provision. It says that the person responsible for making a payment referred on subsection 1 shall the purpose of estimating income of necessity or accounting the tax deductible under subsection 1 obtain from the assessee the evidence or a proof or a particulars of prescribed claims including claim of set off of losses under the provisions of the Act in such form and manner as may be prescribed. Friends, so far they are not prescribed any format and a particular rule. Earlier they had a forum in November 2011, they had one forum told to see employee supposed to give a declaration saying that this is the my other income, these are the deductions I am going to claim, this is the my net taxable income. Now this year they say added, as a employer, as a drawing officer, you have to consider evidence and proof or particulars of the prescribed claims. It means that employer has to collect from the employees evidence, proof or particulars of claims. It means in case of investment under ADC, employer should consider the proof of investment. How it is possible to get a proof of investment in the beginning of the year? You have a time to invest up to 31st March. ADC of 1.5 lakhs, you have a time to invest in the, by the year end. But they expected to give the proof of investment in the beginning of the year. I think this is going to be a very practical problem for all the employers, all also employees, how to consider the deduction. If a strict employer says, no, I will not consider the chapter 68 deduction unless you give me a proof of payment. ATC, all the investment proof. Donation, give me a proof. All the things you give, then I will consider. Loss, you give me a proof of interest paid loss. I think now they want all proof, then only allow. I think this is a, because to curb some of the people who have misutilized this provision and claim some unnecessary deductions, even though they are not made investment, to curb such practices, maybe some percentage, now 100% of the people are punished by saying that you give me a proof, then only give you a deduction. I think this is going to be a practical problem for all the employers. I feel that you have to represent properly to the finance minister saying that it is a something, somebody is doing a mistake, you punish them in a different way. Not the, all the other people, you say, in the beginning of the year, you give me a proof, how it is possible. Otherwise, first 3 months, no deductions. For the next 6 months, you can give the deduction. Whether it is possible, by the time you already deducted tax also. I think this is going to be a practical problem. Earlier it was not there, but through this Finance Act, they introduced this problem, practically lot of problems, lot of issues on this. Next, friends, the 194A, this is a very interesting amendment done in 194A. Any person who is dealing with any cooperative bank know what are the issues? Sir, next is 194A. You know 194A deals with the, whenever you make a TDS, whenever you make a payment to a, interest payment to any person as a depositor or advance, if the payment is more than 10,000 in a financial year, you have to deduct taxes source under 194A at 10%. Right, sir? This is the provision is there for so many years. Next is now, 1st June 2015, is the Finance Act 2015, the Finance Minister changed some of the clauses, that is in 194A subclass 3, subclass 5, he is inserted, earlier clause was, such income created or paid by a cooperative society to a member thereof, or such income credited or paid by a co-producer to any other co-producer site is not TDS. This subclass 3 deals with the exemption. When a co-producer is paying interest to members, a co-producer paying interest to members or to any other co-producer, no TDS. Because exemption is there in 184A subclass 3, subclass 5. This what happened is, if the department started saying that this provision is applicable only to a cooperative society, not to cooperative banks. What happened? All cooperative banks saying that I am a cooperative society first, therefore this exemption you have to give it. These are a lot of for against case laws so far. But the one of the Karnataka was the worst affected on this provision. The Belagam site is the worst affected from Belagam and Bijapur, where they start saying that cooperative bank is not a cooperative society, therefore this exemption is not allowed to cooperative bank. They say you're not deducted, therefore 40A1A, you know, and the taxed huge amount. Then the cooperative bank represented the finance ministry in the month of December 2014. They said that, sir, cooperative bank is exempted under 184A, subclass 3, subclass 5. And why your department people are harassing us by invoking 41A, even though you are not allowed to deduct, they are making all this in, I think is unfair. Then they requested, saying that you make law very clear. You make law very clear, saying that we are entitled for deduction exemption. That is what is the representation memorandum made by the Cooperative Federation. What happened? Finance Minister thought, yes, I will make very clear to you, I will amend the law. From 1st June 2020, you are allowed to deduct taxes. Okay, he has made very clear in law saying that from 1st June 2015, cooperative banks are allowed to deduct taxes source even though you have made payment to a member or a non-member over a payment, you have to deduct taxes. It means up to 31st May, we have a confusion. Still confusion continues. Whether to deduct taxes source up to 31st May, or because law says only 1st June 2015, you have to deduct taxes. It means that earlier credit is not there. That is our interpretation. But department is no. That is still you have to deduct for the earlier period. Anyhow, now the clarification has come. CBDT has clarified. First time CBDT has clarified the doubts. Otherwise, usually CBDT creates the doubts, not clarifying the doubts. First time they have clarified through a circular 19/2015, para 42.5, they clarified very clearly saying that this provision what we introduce, it is effective from 1st June. It means that whatever the interest paid to member, after 1st June you have to deduct actual source. Up to 31st May, you are not required to deduct actual source on member. They have clarified very clearly. But friends, so many petitions, so many appeals are pending before the tribunal, High Court, Karnataka High Court. Based on this circular, recently Karnataka High Court has held saying that the ministry is, sorry, the department is very clear that it is not applicable, and they said that whatever the interest paid to a member up to 31st May 2015, you are not required to deduct tax sources, therefore you are not required to deduct tax sources, therefore 41A cannot be invoked. This is the judgment. Anyway, now from 1st June 2015 is very clear, cooperative bank has deduct tax sources, or you may pay interest more than 10,000 to any person. As a department member or non-member, you have to deduct tax sources. Now, cooperative banks pay, you have to deduct TDS on the interest paid to member deposit if such interest exceeds 10,000 with effect from 1st June 2015. Very clear, prospective effect. Cooperative bank pays interest to other cooperative societies, no TDS. When a cooperative bank paying interest to other cooperative societies, no TDS. Whether a cooperative society is a cooperative society or a credit cooperative society or anything, you are not going to deduct tax source. One more amendment to 184A. They said that threshold limit earlier, defined in the act itself, threshold limit of 10,000 per financial year for branch wise. Suppose a Canara bank having a 2,600 branches, suppose a cooperative bank having some 15-20 branches in Bangalore, each branch wise, suppose one member keeping 1 lakh rupees, he is getting 9,000 rupees on branch. Another branch in Malaysia, he paying another 1 lakh, he is getting 9,000 rupees. In another branch, another 20,000 he is getting at 4,500. Like that, he is giving FD in some 7-8 branches. All interest payment from each branches is less than 10,000. No TDS up to 31st May 2015. Now, From 1st June 2015, they said this threshold limit is not branch wise, it should be bank wise. It means that if a Canara Bank, if you keep in 10-15 branches, all 10-15 branches together, your interest payment is more than 10,000, then you have to deduct tax source. Then you have to deduct tax source. Where should you deduct tax? Yeah, which branch you have to deduct? It is going to be a practical difficulty. They say because you are a CBS software, once you take DR Venkatesh, DR Venkatesh FDs in all the 2,600 branches, if you give it, then everything reflected, then you have to deduct 10% on the what are the interest paid. Okay? That's what they said. Core banking solution, if you have, then no problem, you can have. Therefore, one amendment now saying that the threshold limit of 10,000 is not branch wise, now bank as a whole. I think now earlier they have to avoid a TDS. You should keep 1 lakh in one branch, another 50,000 another branch, another 1 lakh in another branch. See that what you get interest is less than 10,000. That is the tax planning. They have to say you avoid TDS. I think that is not possible now. You have to now all bank branches together of a bank, if it is more than 10,000, they have to be deduct tax source.
Sir,
different banks is okay. Canara Bank, you getting less than 10, no problem. Vijaya Bank, you are getting less than 10, no problem. You are getting in Punjab National, be less than, no problem. But same branches have the same bank. Suppose 4 or 5 branches of the same bank, you are getting more than 10,000, then TDS is a
which branch should be like
that? That is the problem. That is your problem. That is actually, that is a, sir, I gave an in-house program for a lot of banks. I told this is a difficult, very practical problem. Therefore, what you have to do is, in a head office, anyway you have a CBS software, in head office you have to monitor how many deposit of a Mr. Customer A. If he have a 10-15 branches FDs, then somebody had to advise how you deduct TDS at the rate of this, and debit is SBI account. Or debit is over the interest payment account. But somebody has to monitor. Therefore, head office is head office, but our own branch. Take for example, I think Canara Bank. Jainagra branch is dedicated to 194A deduction. Throughout 2,600 branches of Canara Bank, they are monitoring, that branch is not doing any general banking. They do only TDS of 194A. Okay? They are deducting and remitting to the government on behalf of all the branches together. Therefore, somebody has to discharge this obligation. You cannot say, no, 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 I am a branch manager for this branch, I am getting only 8,000 rupees, why I have to deduct? Another branch also is paying 8,000, 16,000 rupees, you also deduct 10% at 800 rupees, other person also deduct at 800. Means you have to deduct at 10%. Then only your obligation of the bank is discharged, otherwise you are liable for all the consequences. Yes, sir.
So I think how they should proceed is identify the person who, for whom the tax collection has to be made. And whichever branch pays interest, you have to deduct tax.
Yes, sir.
That would be simple.
Not correct. That's what happens. Somebody has to monitor and tell. Right, this gentleman whose deposit is so much, he is exceeded 10,000 rupees. Please deduct 10% over paying interest. If we all are deduct 10%, fine, it is no problem. But somebody has to tell no. Otherwise, this man, branch manager sitting in the branch, he has to monitor whether DR Venkatesh has deposit in all the branches. That is, I think, practically different. Therefore, somebody has to monitor and tell, saying that so and so is having a deposit in other branches, please deduct. You deducted 10%, you deducted 10%.
Respective like, branch should deduct.
Yes, sir.
Respective branch
should deduct at 10% is fine. Once you exceed 10,000, that is the best. Otherwise, dedicated to branch. Or suppose you have 20-30 branch, head office, one team, only TDS deducted and remitting to the government. That is the issue there.
There will be two different DR organizations in two different cities.
No, but if it is a different panel, no problem. But if it is same, is a problem. I think. DR Venkatesh having in Mumbai branch is maybe DR Venkatesh is not Damgiri Ramana Venkatesh. It may be DR, but it is that represent for a different thing. But you have to find out whether DR Venkatesh, what is having PAN, same PAN, then it will be issue. But there is no chance, no? There is no chance of same PAN. Then is, friends, time deposit definition earlier, 194A says, oh, time deposit means, which is a deposit which is repayable at a particular period, is a time deposit. RD was not a time deposit. Earlier definition, RD was not a time deposit. Now they say RD also time deposit. Recurring deposit in a bank, it is also a time deposit. Therefore, if you pay interest on RD plus other time deposit, altogether if you pay more than 10,000 rupees, you have to deduct TDS at the rate of 10%. It means they, in the 194A, they amended cooperative bank also deduct TDS, that the exemption under 194A, subclass 3, subclass 5 is not applicable, one amendment. Then threshold limit of 10,000, not branch wise, bank wise, next amendment. Time deposit includes RD, this is another amendment. In 194A, I think finance minister, when a representative came from Karnataka, he thought, okay, I will do all this repairing work, see that everybody will be liable for it. That is now, this is the amendment which is effective from 1st June. Friends, kindly note, no, when you are collecting threshold limit, don't include SP interest, don't include if you are paying interest on current account. That is not a term deposit, you should not be included. Suppose you are paying a interest and SP of crore rupees, it will not come under TDS process. Only time deposit will come for the threshold limit and for TDS. Not the SP savings for company will not be covered under.
TDS and RD, it is at the year of the payment?
Yeah. The year of payment means suppose year end you make an entry, then you have to deduct. If you have not made the payment to a depositor, but you make a provision in your books of accounts, yearly or half yearly or quarterly, at that time you have to deduct that. TDS is very clear at time of payment or date, whichever is earlier. You pass the entries here on a quarterly basis, making a provision for all TDS interest, quarterly or half yearly or yearly. If you are doing on that quarterly, you have to deduct TDS on quarterly, half yearly means half yearly, or yearly means year.
But a customer will be showing
us
income only in the year.
Sir, customer is showing in his hand, maybe after maturity, it is no criteria. For TDS is maybe mismatch between all the 26 years, all the 6 is different. But for the TDS is at the time payment or date, whichever is you have to deduct tax source.
Post office?
That also. Post office also. The 194A provision, they made very clearly that in this bill, finance bill, they clarified that amended so as to expressly provide that exemption provided for deduction of tax from payment of interest to members by a cooperative society under 194A, 3 of the income tax shall not apply to a payment of interest on time deposit by a cooperative bank interest member. It means this provision of exemption given under 194A, subclass 3, subclass 5 is not applicable to cooperative. They have clarified very clearly. Now, the amendment is very clear, it is effective from 1st June 2015. Now, we can tablet all the amendments made in Finance Act 2015, effective from 1st June 2015. Cooperative bank paying any interest to a member or a non-member, if it exceeds 10,000 rupees, from 1st June 2015, you have to deduct tax source. Yes, TDS is applicable from 1st June 2015. A cooperative society paying a cooperative society, whether a credit cooperative society or a housing cooperative society or a federation of cooperative society, paying interest to any member or other cooperative society, no TDS, amount may be any amount. Cooperative bank paying to cooperative society, no TDS, because exemption under 194A, subclass 3, subclass 5 continues. A cooperative bank paying to cooperative bank, TDS attracts or not? I left two these questions to you. Answer me whether when you pay a cooperative bank to another cooperative, take for example Karnataka State Apex Cooperative Bank, paying interest to another urban cooperative bank, bus fisher cooperative bank, some cooperative bank here, they are paying interest, it is more than 10,000, whether you deduct TDS or not?
Yes.
Yes. You have to deduct. My answer is no. Because you read this section 194A, subclass 3, subclass 3, Roman 3. It says very clearly, any interest paid to a society or to a bank, which is covered by the Banking Regulation Act, BR Act, no TDS. It means cooperative bank paid to another cooperative bank, a receiving bank is a bank, a society which is covered by the Banking Regulation Act, no TDS. Under subclass 3 of 194A, like manner, cooperative society paying to another cooperative bank, no TDS, because exempt under subclass 3. Clear, sir? This is what the amendment. Then contract payment, it is a very interesting amendment that done by the finance ministry. Yes, sir.
Paid. I'm a business owner and I take a loan from a cooperative bank and I pay interest to them.
Not a direct, not necessarily direct tax source. You're not a direct.
Any cooperative bank or nationalized bank, no interest.
Sir, any bank, any institution for which Banking Regulation Act is applicable, you are not necessarily direct tax source. Suppose you take a housing loan from Canara Bank, you are taking a housing loan from a cooperative bank, you are not required to deduct TDS because the Banking Regulation Act is covered. Not required to deduct TDS. We come to a contract payment. Under 194C, all of you know, threshold limit is 30,000 for each contract, but each contract is less than 30,000, but total payment in a financial year to that.
Sir, interest.
Sir, interest.
Yes, sir. SP account, interest taken more than 10,000, they are deducting the TDS, and there is a section 194 TT.
TTI?
Yes, sir.
ETI?
ETI. ETI, ETI, sir.
What is the TTI?
Exemption, sir. 10,000.
Sir, SP interest, I told you TDS is not applicable. Today I am on only topic of TDS. I am not on the SP interest liable for tax and other thing. I am not there. Is liable for tax. Friends, whatever interest you receive from the banks or a cooperative society or from a financialized bank is liable for income tax. Whether you get 500 rupees, you are liable for income tax. Including your income, pay tax. What are the applicable tax to you? What I am talking today is TDS. Applicable under 184A. But if you are getting a SP interest from any bank, and not necessarily a cooperative bank, even from nationalized bank, you are getting 1 crore SP interest, no TDS. But you have to pay tax. And today I am talking of only TDS, not on the income tax. Okay, clear. I think ATTTA claiming all exemption is under the normal provision. Today I am on TDS. Okay? Therefore, TDS is not applicable on SP interest. Okay? Now is 194C, friends, contract payment. The threshold limit is each contract is less than 30,000, no TDS, correct? But each contract is less than 30,000, but total payment to that contractor is more than 75,000 in a financial year, then you have to deduct tax. It means suppose I deduct, first is 20,000, I am not deducted. Next is another 20,000, not deducted. Next is I am paying a 40,000 rupees. Then you have to deduct on full amount. What are the amount paid earlier also you have to be subject to 194C. This is a threshold limit computation. You know who are the specified person to be covered under the 194C. What is a contract? What is a work? Rate of TDS is, if the person who is receiving from you is an individual or HF, 1%. Person who is receiving from you is a other than individual HF is 2%. This is only simple rate. But now I am coming to the very important thing is transport contractor. Transport contractor. What happened? This section is every year some amendment. From 2009 onwards is an amendment. If you want to recapture your memory, they said the transport contractor, if you give a declaration in 59, then no TDS. That is one problem. Earlier, 2009. Subsequently, they said that if a PAN number is furnished by the transport contractor, no TDS. Whether he is owning 200 lorries, whether owning 20 lorries, up to 31st May 2015, they say that if you give a PAN number, no TDS at all. But finance minister thought, what is this? A lot of people are misutilizing this provision. I want to restrict that. Yes, you are entitled for exemption provided you are not owning more than 10 lorries in a financial year. Therefore, he has added from 1st June 2015. Can you note this amendment is from 1st June 2015? Where such contractor owns 10 or less goods carriage at any time during the financial year, previous year, furnish a declaration to that effect along with his permit account number to the person paying or creating such amount. Then you will not know TDS at all. It means now the requirement now is from 1st June up to 31st May 2015, from 2009 to 31st May 2015, if a contractor gives a declaration saying that this is my PAN number, I am a transport contractor, give that, no TDS at all. Irrespective of any number of lorries, any amount, that is the provision up to 30%. Now they amended, it saying that you should give a declaration saying that you are owning only 10, less than 10 lorries in a previous year. This previous year, financial year 15-16, you have to give a declaration in a particular format saying that my PAN number, I am owner of these vehicles, I am owning less than 10 lorries. And as you give a declaration, any time exceeds more than 10 lorries, I inform the deductor. That is the original declaration. Now they have modified. This is the declaration. It means that this exemption of 194C, subclass 6, is available for persons who are having less than 10 lorries in a previous year. It means as a deductor, you have to ascertain from each lorry contractor how many lorries you are owning. He says less than 10 lorries, give me the details. Okay, this is the declaration form. I think this looks to be not a problem, but I am having some problems. Whether it is applicable to agents, Sir, usually you book through your agent. Correct? A large transport contract business today goes through an agent. You don't know who is the owner of the vehicle. You say, I want 2 lorries from Bangalore to Calcutta. You are paying some 1 lakh rupees. This is, you are making a payment to the agent. The agent in turn is making a payment to the lorry owners or the drivers. Usually lorry owners will not be there, you will be a driver. Whether you give a declaration, whether it is applicable to the agent first. A 194C subclause 6, which is introduced even earlier also now, whether it is applicable to an agent. Agent means he is not a owner. If he is only arranging vehicles for you, whether this exemption is available to the agent or not, that is the question. Tell me, sir, now. I want your views. Applicable or not applicable? What you are doing so far? I think you are advising on this particular provision. Earlier also it was there. Tell me whether you are giving exemption or not giving exemption.
Sir,
there is
a question regarding
the
provision of agent is not a owner.
Yes.
Provision says that owner owning less than 10 trucks.
My friend says that owning means that is the principle that you have to decide. If he is owning less than 10 lorries, I can give an exemption. If he is not owning, here in the case, agent is not owning any vehicle. He is only organizing. He is coordinating with the lorry owners or lorry drivers with the company. Person who wanted transport his items. Therefore, he is not entitled for this exemption. Yes. Now made very clearly from 27 November 2015. Friends, 27 November 2015, CBDT is clarified through a circular number 19/2015, dated 27 November 2015, para number, I'll give the para number, around 42 point something.
So how can CBDT override that, sir?
Welcome.
Sir, if you read the para 43, there are around 5 subclasses para is there. Please read, you want to know 194C, this one. Read all these sub 5 paras, then you will know how to apply this 194C. As per this very clear, want to get an exemption under 194C subclass 6, you should be owner. Earlier, no clarification. Now they say very clearly, it is not applicable to agents. That is very clear. It means it is applicable only to owners. Correct, sir? Agents are not entitled for the exemption under owners. This is over. Next. Here is a case where T is an individual transport contractor. He owns a 5 goods carriage from the 1st April 2015 to 31st October 2015. Correct, sir? He is owning less than 5 vehicles during this period, April 2015 to 31st October. On 1st November 2015, he purchased 6 more goods carriage. Now for 1st November 2015, he purchased another 6. If total number of vehicles is
11.
On 1st January 2016, he sold 8 vehicles. Then how much is having? 3. Okay? This is the fact. Now you tell me, T makes the payment to the following transport contractor T during the financial year 15-16. 15th April 2015, he is making 35,000. Whether it is entitled for 194C6 exemption, please examine it because it is a very interesting issue. Whether it is entitled for exemption?
Yes.
For if you see, before 31st March 2015, anybody who is a transport contractor, you give the PAN number, threshold limit is not applicable. Therefore, you make 1 crore payment also, you will be exempt from TDS. Exempt from TDS. Up to 31st May, that is the position. Threshold limit is no threshold limit for 194C subclass 6. If you are making a payment, anything exempted provided it is a PAN number. Okay. On 15 July 2015, I paid 40,000 rupees. What was my position? 15 July, I had 5 carriages. It means from 1st June, the law changed. Therefore, law change for 1st June, I had only 5 vehicles at that time, even 40,000 also exempted. Correct, sir?
Yes.
40,000 also exempt from you because I am less than 10 vehicles. Amount is not the criteria. 184C subclass, threshold limit of 30,000 is not 5. Next on 15th November 2015, I paid 20,000 rupees. That day, 1st November 2015, I purchased another 6 more. From 1st June 2015, my number of vehicles I'm owning is 11. Therefore, whether I'm entitled for payment which is made on 15th November 2015, 20,000, whether to deduct TDS or not?
Yes.
Hmm?
Yes. No, no.
You have to come to the general provision of the 194C. Yes. For calculation of threshold limit of 70,000, 75,000, you have to see what is the payment effected after 1st June 2015. 1st June, because this provision you have to read from 1st June to the 1st June to the 15, I paid 40 plus 20, less than threshold limit. No TDS on 20,000. Okay? Next. 15th December 2015, I have made another 20,000. What happens now? 80,000 now. 80,000. I will deduct on 80,000 or only 20,000? 80,000. 80,000. But already I have made the payment.
Balance of 20,000 you have to
tax. Thanks to the circular, he says that in future you have to deduct not for the earlier payment. This is very great. Otherwise, usually they say deduct for the earlier period also. Now they clarified in the circular. You deduct 200 rupees on this payment. So next, 50,000.
Only for transporter or for others also?
No, no, transporter, sir, please, please. Why you are suddenly confused? No, 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 I am giving explanation for 194 subclass 6 only. It is only for transporter, not for other contractor. Please kindly note, I am discussing only transport contract. Next is on 15th February 2016, I have paid 50,000. That day, I am owning only three vehicles. What to do? Whether to deduct TDS or not to deduct? Yes. See, provision says anytime during the year, if you exist and you are not eligible for the thing. It means that for this, even though you are owning only three vehicles, this exemption is not available. Please deduct 500 rupees. What are that? 1% on this 15th February 2016 payment. Friends, this example is from this circular. I have taken same figure. Please read it. Circular bar 19/2015, dated 27/2015. This is explaining all the provisions of what is introduced in the Finance Act 2015 clarification. Go to paragraph 43. It gives the clue that once you have violated or once you have exceeded the threshold limit, future payment you have to deduct TDS, not for the earlier payment. It is a great to the, this is very clear to the client. Therefore, you can apply. This is, my view is based on the circular, sir. This, my view, what we have done today is based on the circular. Otherwise, earlier I used to tell them, no, 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 earlier payment also you have to deduct TDS. But because now clarification is very clear, therefore you can apply this clarification. Clear, sir? I think this is very interesting because all of you facing every day these problems. Usually, over the phone, sir, I am transport contractor. You say, less than 10 lakh, I don't deduct. Or deduct 10%, deduct 1%. Simply like that. That is not. Please tell the law. Our practical view is different. But legal, what is the view? Then practically, you take different view. That is a different thing. But what I am telling today is illegal. Okay? Next. 194H, threshold limit is 5000. Friends, this 5000 is continuing for so many years. Actually, you know, recently, the Finance Ministry is appointed on called a committee on simplification of tax laws. I think the Ishwar, Chartered Accountant, also a former president and judge of the Delhi High Court, he is the chairman of this committee. He has given a recommendation. In this, said that you have to revisit all these threshold limit. If he has mentioned this 15,000, it should be increased to 15,000. You know, 15,000 also less, but he has said that this limit should be increased to 15,000. All the threshold limit fixed for the TDS. Here they have said in the committee, increase the threshold limit to 50,000, one act like that, they have given various threshold limit. We have to see whether Finance Minister is going to consider another 15 days, we will know what is this figure, what is going to be. This is what recommended, but 5,000, TDS is 10%. Rent, you know, threshold limit is 1,80,000 in a financial year. Rate of reduction is for use of land and building is 10%, for use of machinery plant is 2%. Threshold limit is 1,80,000. If you call as a rent, whether machinery rent or a plant rent or a hire charges, 1.8 is the threshold limit. TDS rate differs. If it is a rent for the usage of land or building is 10%, for usage of a machinery plant is 2%. You must know what is the rent. Rent definition is a big definition. Whether you are owner or not, if you are getting anything on account of leasing land, building, machinery, plant, equipment, it is a rent, you have to get taxes.
I have a question.
Sir,
yes, sir. If it's a new rental agreement starting on 1st April, you know, and the rent for the whole year is going to cost 1 lakh, you know that. Is it supposed to deduct, you know, for the entire...
Sir, you are making payment? You are making monthly or paying in advance?
Monthly.
If you are paying monthly, you have to deduct monthly. But you estimate the threshold bid for full year is 1.8 above, 1,80,000 more, then you have to deduct on each payment. Each payment. Suppose you are making advance payment. Suppose 5 years together, I am an example, where you are going to pay for the next 5 years into whatever the amount, 20,000 rupees per month into 5 years. For full amount, you have to deduct at the time of advance payment itself. Not necessarily monthly, you have to deduct it. Payment or credit, whichever is necessary. In your case, agreed is 15 or 20,000 rupees per month, but you are making monthly payment or quarterly payment at the time of payment or at the time of passing an rent account debit to owner account, that time you have to deduct TDS. That is the requirement.
Sir.
Sir.
That doesn't
that
TDS you said no rent, it's inclusive of service tax?
I'll come to this. I might have a separate slide after.
Second,
194. You can defer that question to the next, so that
194, yeah, small
tower. Yes, sir.
That auto financing.
Auto?
Auto financing.
Okay.
So what happens is facilitator will be there. He gets some margin.
Based on the sale value or based on the number of vehicles sold?
Yeah.
Okay. It is a commission. Yeah, it is a commission. Whether you call it a commission, brokerage, but you are getting something based on the procurement of a business.
Yeah.
It comes as a commission. Where your relation is a principal agent relationship. Your relationship here is a principal and agent relationship. You are working on behalf of the principal, it is a commission, or you call it an incentive, you call it as a brokerage, you call it whatever the name you want, still 194H is attracted at 10%. I'll come to the service tax later. 194IA, payment to a transfer of certain immovable property other than agricultural land, effective from 1 June 2013, payment to a resident. When you are making a payment to a resident, it means it is an obligation of the buyer. Seller is the buyer is the resident. It is an obligation is the buyer is the resident. Payment to a resident. It means seller is also a resident. Non-resident means 195 tract. A seller should be a resident. Buyer may be a non-resident also if this process is applicable. Suppose you are buying a non-resident buying an apartment, it is more than 50,000 rupees. When you are making a payment, you have to deduct tax source at 1% under 194IA. If the seller is the non-resident, then 195. You are clear, sir? Here is payment to a resident, then transfer of immovable property other than agricultural land, consideration to be 50 lakhs and more, TDS is 1%, not necessary to obtain TAN number, you know 26 cubic chalan, both buyer and seller, PAN number you have to report, then you get it. Now the problem is, two seller, two buyer, or four buyer, one seller, this problem will be there, but each consideration, if a buyer is paying a consideration more than 50,000, then these projects are applicable. If it is a joint agreement, or it is a sale agreement, is a joint agreement where you are your share and very clearly mentioned in the agreement saying that my share is only less than 50,000, 50 lakhs, there is no TDS. But if it is more than 50 lakhs, then yet buyers is the criteria to decide. How much is paying? His consideration is more than 50 lakh, TDS is attracted. TAN is not required. You can make the payment by using a PAN number buyer as well as seller. 194J is very near to us. All of you know threshold limit is 30,000, rate of TDS is 10%. I am not taking because you are all aware. 194.5, payment to a non-resident with effect from 1 June 2015, there is a change. Earlier, what is a, whenever you make a payment to a non-resident, which charge up to income tax, which is chargeable to income tax, then will be 195 is attracted. Now this 195 subclause says that person responsible for paying to a non-resident, not being a company or a foreign company, any sum, whether or not, earlier only chargeable tax was subject to this 195 deduction. Now we say whether or not chargeable to under the provisions of the Act, even though it is not liable to income tax, shall furnish information related to the payment of such sum in such form, manner as may prescribe. It is not a TDS. Some information you have to give to the department. It means you have to follow rule 37BB, 15 CA, you know, 15 CB, chart account to certify whether liable for TDS or not liable. It means that from 1st June 2015, any payment in a foreign currency to any is maybe you are importing a raw material or importing a capital item for which no TDS, is not liable for income tax at all, is settled outside. Is not liable income tax under 195, but still you have to follow the procedure of 195 subclause 6 under 1st June 2015. But the RBI, with the consent of the finance ministry, they issued a circular on 1st June 2020 saying that there are 20 items for which no certificate is required. For 20 items, no certificate is required. But all these items regarding donation, government organization, all the same. Now, friends, very sharp. Now they said that from 1st April 2015, this requirement is not there. It's only for 9 months period. 1st June to 31st March is 31st March. Now from 1st April, they say that in respect of a payment which is not chargeable to income tax under 195, don't require a certificate in this particular format. You have to give a certificate only with when his income is chargeable to tax. It means as an auditor, as a consultant, when you give a certificate, you have to see this payment is whether liable to tax in India, then you have to give a certificate in 15 CB, otherwise not required. Up to 31st May 2016, whether it is chargeable tax or not, you have to give the certificate. This is the requirement. Clear, sir? Now, for 1st April 2000, there is again change in the procedure. Friends, all the defaults in the Chapter 17B can be listed in the following manner. There may be a non-deduction, not deducted term, or short deduction, or delay in deduction, remittance, non-remittance, short remittances, delay in remittances, or not filing of quarterly return, or delay in filing quarterly return, form 1616 and not issued, or delay in issuing. These are the defaults you can commit in Chapter 17. This is not important, but important is consequences. The consequences for default of any Chapter 17B compliances are, friends, is interest under 2011A for non-deduction 1%, non-remittance 1.5%, 1.5% per month. Fees. Any delay in filing your quarterly return, fees under 234A, I think all of you receiving a love letter from the treasurers, when you file quarterly return, you get immediately, within 3 days, you get a notice where delay in filing into number of days delay into 200 rupees, they will levy, correct? 234E, penalty. Under 271H, any delay or any wrong filing of quarterly return, you are liable for penalty under 271H, 10,000 to 1 lakh rupees. Disallowance. Friends, I think you know disallowance very clearly, 40A1A. If you are not deducted, or deducted not remit taxes to the government, 40A1A disallowance. Next is compounding fee, prosecution. Deducted not remit to the government, prosecution under 276B. Compounding fee, these are all the things I am taking late now. First is interest under 2011A. Friends, from 1st June 2006, mandatory you have to pay interest. There is no reasonable cost, no explanation, any delay, you have to pay interest. Non-deduction 1%, non-remittance or delay in remittances 1.5% per month. There is no excuse at all. You cannot say my accountant was not there, I am having reasonable cost, strike, back, all this, no. Mandatory, you have to say, your due date is 7th, you are not remitted on 7th, you are remitting on 8th, you are liable for interest. Mandatory, along with your quarterly return, you have to pay this interest payment. That is the requirement. Don't wait for the TDS notice. Next is 234E for defaulting furnishing statement. With effect from 1st July 2012, very clear, fees for defaulting furnishing statement in a prescribed time, you know, time is quarterly basis, next month 15. In case of default, you are liable to pay 200 rupees per day of every day of during the failure continues. Such fee shall not exceed the amount of tax deducted or collected during that particular part. It means 200 meter starts. One delay, the 15th July is a due date. If you have not filed on 15th July, from 16th onwards starts meter. When you file it, it stops there. Including Saturday, including Sunday, number of days calculated into 200 rupees. Compulsory 234E is the, that is what? Delay in default for furnishing statement.
If the filing date is Sunday, sir, that means...
Yeah, next working day is the due date.
No, but they have sent 200 rupees.
That is not, if it is a, any day, any due date falls on a public holiday or a general holiday, as per General Clause Act, next working day is the due date. You can write, but it is not worth writing because rule rupees you have to correspond with supremacy is difficult, you pay practically okay, paying. But it is substantially confirmed. As per General Clause, next working day is the due date. Now is with the effect from 1st July 2012, 271 which I told you, penalty level in case of failure to deliver the or cost to deliver the statement, that is a 24Q, 20Q, you are not filed within the time, or you are filed it but is incorrect information statement, you are wrong PAN number, wrong challan number, wrong amount, wrong assessment year if you have mentioned, then you are liable for penalty 10,000 to 1 lakh. Minimum is 10,000, maximum is 1 lakh. Penalty shall not be levied for tax and interest as been paid before the expiry of 1 year. You are default, you accrued within 1 year of time, it means whatever the delay you have within 12 months delay, within 12 months delay, there will not levy penalty. If it is more than 12 months, you are liable for 234E as well as penalty under 271. Both consequences will attract. Clear, sir?
Can you repeat, sir?
Sir, penalty. Sir, penalty is 271, it says that is a penalty for delay in filing quarterly return or failure to file the quarterly return or furnishing incorrect information in the quarterly return.
That means the 26EH form, right?
26Q or 26 4.
In that something, some
24Q.
Yeah, by mistake, some panel mistake will be happening.
If you rectified yourself, no problem. If you are not rectified, they found out that there is an incorrect.
Many cases we found out.
Then you are liable for penalty.
All the mistakes are there from the
banker's
side, rejecting that and filing
the
this one. Quarterly returns.
Quarterly return, if you buy, bank is liable for penalty. Why you bother? Also, deductor is liable for penalty. So, here is any delay in filing or wrong filing of data or wrong information in the quarterly return, you are liable for penalty. But this, if you have delay in filing is less than 12 months, then not no penalty, only a 234. But it is more than 12 months, then suppose a quarterly return of June 2015, if you are not filed before June 2016, suppose more than 12 months, then you attract 234E as well as 271H. You have to pay 234E 2 rupees per day fees as well as penalty under 271H, 10,000 to 1 lakh. Anyway, both will attract. This is the consequences if it is a delay is more than 12 months.
This delay is 12 months is from the due date or the filing?
From the due date. Not from filing. Due date is the criteria. Sir?
Within the due date it is rectified?
Sir, if you rectified, no issues.
Within the due date.
Within the due date, if filed, within the due date, if rectified the errors, no penalty, no 234.
But they send the notice.
No, it is wrong. If they send a notice, it is wrong. But if you have filed the return within the due date and rectified the errors yourself, before the due date or after the due date, but first original return you have filed within the due date and rectified subsequently before getting the notice from the treasurer, you are definitely out of the penalty, out of the 234. Next is penalty. Failure to furnish the statement. This I discussed very clearly. Prosecution. This is the last consequences. The deductor is liable for prosecution with a rigorous imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 3 months, but it may extend to 7 years with fine. This is a minimum 3 months, maximum 7 years. This is applicable where you are deducted, not remitted to the taxes to the government. Where your default is related to non-remitting of taxes. Non-deduction will not attract prosecution. But where you are deducted, retain the government money with you and not remitted the taxes to the government, definitely it attracts prosecution, minimum 3 months, maximum 7 years, free boarding in a government guest house, free boarding lodging in a government guest house. But you don't want free boarding lodging, then you can go for a compounding fee. He says, I don't want prosecution, I am ready to pay compounding fee, then 3% per month is the compounding fee, plus they add some service charges of the department, they add some lawyer fees. All together, you have to make a proper representation, application saying that I don't want prosecution, I am ready to go for a compounding fee through the proper service commissioner TDS, then it goes to the chief commissioner, then they approve, because you are a fit case to give a compounding fee. They will give it, you will give it, they will say this is the 3% plus service charges plus they add some charges. All together you have to pay within 30 days. If you pay within 30 days from the date of communication, then out of the prosecution proceedings. Otherwise you are continued to be possible. This case prosecution will continue. Once you apply compounding fee, they have to dispose of your compounding fee, the compounding application. If you dispose of, then you are outside the prosecution. Otherwise, prosecution proceedings continue. Survey under TDS. With effect from 1st October 2014, friends, survey under 133A is recognized for TDS also. Earlier, survey is only for business and for other normal circumstances, declaring more income and other. But now TDS survey is there. Under 133 capital 2A, anybody comes from the TDS circle, say that they want to do a survey, they are definitely entitled to survey, but they cannot impound the retaining books of account. They cannot do that. And they cannot check cash. They cannot check stock. What they can do? They can check only TDS transactions. Whether you file the return, they can scan the ledger, whether all transactions you have deducted TDS, that they can do it. They cannot check inventory, they cannot check cash. TDS survey officials come to your counter saying that how much cash is there, I want to come. No, it is not for me. You cannot check the inventory, you cannot check the cash, you cannot impound the books of accounts. You can check only, take the copies of the your TDS written and other things, but you cannot import the books of. This is, we have to be very clear. Any TDS survey only restricted to verify the transaction of TDS and take the TDS returns and not any other books of account. It is not permitted. Processing of statement of tax return. So, it is there from 1st April 2000. Now, the, what you are getting traces. Notice that is a separate processing under 200 capital A. They, what are the quarterly return, they will process it, but they can process within the time. The time limit is not after 6-7 years from the end of the financial year. They have to process your return, whatever you have filed, within 7 years from the end of the financial year. They cannot exceed that. They cannot go 10 years back and ask the improvement. They cannot process and demand the time. Within 7 years from the end of the financial year, they have to process and issue a notice, that water traces notice, asking to pay taxes or a short interest or the tax short deducted and also and the fees under 234E. Under friends, I want to tell you, 234E introduced from 1st July 2012. They said that if you delay filing quarterly return, you are liable for 200 rupees per day. But there is an Amritsar branch decision. It says that you cannot collect 200 rupees from the deductor because there is no enabling provision under section 200 capital A. If you see 200 capital A is the return which gives the power to the TDS officer to collect the tax from you. A short deduction, short interest is a power. In that, by oversight, they have not included fees. 234E, they are not included. Therefore, Amendments took a decision saying that 234E is a constitutional value, but there is no enabling provision to collect the tax from the deductor. Up to 31st May 2015, you cannot collect the taxes from the deductor, sorry, fees from the deductor. Therefore, if in any cases you have a where they levied 234E for a period up to 31st May 2015, you have a definite case, go for appeal. All the commissioners in Bangalore and other places, they are disposed giving a relief to the deductor. 1st June 2015, the law is amended. Now in 200 capital A, they have added fees also. Therefore, enabling provision is made now. Therefore, from 1st June 2015, they can collect the 234 fee also. Therefore, up to 31st May, is not possible because there is no enabling provision in section 200 capital A. This is what I want to do. Inform you, friend. Circular. What my friend asked, whether I include service tax or not. I want to take four circulars so that discuss. In the circular 4/2008, dated 28th April 2008, the CBDT has issued a circular. The circular 4/2008, they made very clearly, any TDS deducted under 194I, you have to deduct TDS only on rent, don't include service tax. It means if 10 lakhs is the rent, and that is suppose present rate is 14,000 rupees or 14,500 rupees, you are paying 1,14,500 rupees, a total gross amount to the owner. But the circular is very clear, please deduct TDS only 10,000, rent portion. don't include service tax under 194i. This was 4.238. Based on this circular, I was giving lot of lecture, saying that the circular is very clear, don't include service tax, therefore don't include service tax and other provisions also. Suddenly after 3 months, CBDT is clarified through a circular, 30th June 2008, they clarified saying that TDS had to deduct on the gross amount inclusive of service tax where a payment is made under 194J and circular 4/2008 dated 28th April 2008 cannot be extended to 194J. They said that 194I excludes service tax, 194J includes service tax. What about other sections? They are not clarified. In 194I, they said, please exclude service tax. Good, very good circular. In 194J, after 3 months, they suddenly realized, no. The benefit of this 4/2000 circular should not be extended to professional payment. You will make very clear under this 30th June circular, saying that, no. For 194J, include service tax. It means you pay 1 lakh auditor fees, you pay another service tax of 10%, 1,10,000, you deduct TDS on 1,10,000 for an auditor. In case of rent, you deduct TDS on only rent portion, don't include it. This is the clarification. April 2008, one clarification, June 2008, different clarification, different. After 6 years, friends, there is one clarification. Circle number 4/2014, 13th January 2014, they clarified. TDS had to deduct on net amount exclusive of service tax where a payment is made under 194J provided that amount of service tax component and fees for professional or technical to be shown separately. It means your bill should be very clear, fees, service tax separately. Then you deduct TDS only fees, not on service tax component. They extended in first para, but they did little. They said board has decided. Now this is that after 6 years, we will clarify saying that where terms of agreement or contract in a payer and paying, service tax component comprising the amount payable to a resident is indicated separately, tax shall be deducted at source under Chapter 17B, all the sections now, all 42 sections of the act on amount of paid or payable without including service tax. It means for first. Circular first for 2014, effective from 13th January 2014 is very clear. If you are mentioned in your contract or agreement or in a bill, service tax component separately, don't include service tax for TDS purpose. Now it is very clear in all the problems. This is what service tax, whether to include or not, this is the clarification. Very clear now. Don't include service tax, it is very clearly mentioned. Now we will come to the issues. Sir, my presentation is over. Now yours. Now you have to, all of you have to react. First, 2011A, you know you have to calculate interest. Correct, sir? You have to calculate interest for a non-deduction or a delayed deduction or delayed remittances. You have to deduct, calculate interest. This case, TDS remitted, deducted on 22nd March 2015. TDS remitted to the government on 8th May. Whether I have to calculate interest for 1 month, 2 months or 3 months? How you calculate 3 months, sir? You calculate 22nd March to?
31st March.
1. It means you have calculated March, April, May. Correct? It means that your answer is correct, but you are wrong. Calculation is wrong. I'll tell you. In another 1 month? Sir, here is the case. I have to remit before 30th April, correct? Year end to pay that only 30th April. But I remitted only 8 days delay. I have to pay 3 months. Or 1 month? Or 2 months? Answer is 3 months. Because law is very clear, rule is very clear. Once you miss the due date, once you miss the due date of 30th April, for calculation of default, you go to the date of deduction. In this case, date of deduction is 22nd March up to 8th May. You have to calculate number of days, not calendar month. you have to calculate number of days. Number of days is less than 30 days, 1 month. 30 to 60, 2 months. 60 to 90, 3 months. More than 90 days, 4 months. You have to calculate like not calendar month. In this case, 22nd March 2015 is 9 months delay, March. April 30, May is 8 days. Total comes to how many months? I think it is at 47 days. 47 days means more than 47 days or how many months? 47 months. Then it comes to 2 months only. 2 months. Not 3 months. Sorry, I told you 3 months. It is at 2 months. Correct? Because you have to calculate number of days default from the date of deduction up to the date of remittance. You calculate, keep it. If it is less than 30 days, 1 month. 30 to 60, 2 months. 60 to 90, 3 months. Like that you have to get. Not on calendar month. Number of days default. But what is the basis for that? You may ask. Friends, please see the rule 119A. Very clearly gives the procedure to be followed in calculating interest. It very clearly says that interest to be calculated on annual basis if the rate prescribed under the section is annum. If the section says that you have to calculate the interest at 12% annum, means you have to calculate on this basis, annual basis. For that purpose, you have to get number of days default. And if it is more than 30 days, less than 30 days, ignore that for the purpose of calculation and calculate only 31 month. In this example, it is 47 days, but interest is calculated per annum basis, then only 1 month. But in our case, in 201A, it says per month basis. Per month basis means they have to calculate number of days, and even a fraction of months should be considered as 1 month, even 1 day delay be considered as 1 month. In our case, 47 days delay, this means 30 plus 17 days, it comes to your 2 months default. Therefore, you have to calculate 2 months. This is a rule 119. Friends, for information, traces what you are getting, this rule is not incorporated in that traces. Actually, we pointed out to the TDS commissioner, he was also a little surprised. Then I told, please incorporate, because you are going to a calendar month. Please incorporate number of days, calculate, give the calculation in your calculation. Suppose interest calculate, you have to give the details. How many days? From the date of deduction up to the date of remittance, calculate so many days. You say calculate how many months. But they are going to make calendar month. I think they told we are going to incorporate. I don't know whether it is incorporated or not today. Somebody told in the earlier forum in Udupi, I was giving the lecture, they told they incorporate. I don't know, in this case, maybe a very strange cases, he calculated it up to be 2 months. Is that it? Take for example this case, go to a 2nd March. Date of deduction is 2nd March. Then how many months? 2nd March means how many days? 29 days, 30 days, and 8 days. It comes to how many months? How many days? 60? 67 days. Then you have 3 months. Therefore, 22nd March means it is only 2 months. 2nd March means it goes to 3 months. Because therefore, if you go by calendar month, both the cases only 3 months there. It is not correct. Therefore, you have to go by the rule, which rule is very clear. Rule 119A gives the procedure of calculation. And also they say that for the calculation of interest and penalty other sum under this Act, under the Income Tax Act, they have to ignore the decimal of this 100. You have to ignore. But they are not ignoring. They are always, even 50 rupees they are calculating, even 2 rupees they are calculating interest. Actually, they have to round it up to 100 rupees. That is the calculation I said. They are ignoring Rule 119 and they are doing it. Therefore, we suggested to the TDS Commissioner, please incorporate in your software so that what are the default, suppose nearest 100 rupees you wrote it, then you calculate the interest. But they are not doing that. Even 52 rupees default, calculate the interest. That is not correct. It is not according to the 119. Next, friends, in this case, ABC company passed the following entries in the books of account. Internet fee payable to a smart associate, internet chart accountant, 1 lakh rupees. Every month they are paying internet fee 1 lakh rupees. In this case, they are not deducted TDS, it is payable for March. Now they come to you. It is they want how much interest you have to pay. March month, they are March month, he is taking year end. 31st March entry. How many months default? What is the rate of interest here? Number of months leave it. whether I have to deduct, calculate interest at 1% or
1.5%.
1%. 1%. It is a non-deduction case, 1%. Very clear? Correct, sir? Here is internet fee, 1 lakh. Credited to smart or social account, 1 lakh. Is a rate of interest is 1%. Correct? Same example, but I pass the interest like this. Internet fee upon debit, credit to smart account 90,000, TDS payable is 10,000. What is a... Here is 1.5%. Because you are already deduct TDS. Actually, virtually is not deduct TDS. Only entry is passed by a smart accountant. Smart accountant entry passed fitting this transaction. You want to show what is TDS payable on any point of time. Say 10,000 is payable, you pass the entries, you have to pay 0.5% extra for your smart entry. Be careful, be careful. This is what a lot of companies want to show TDS payable. But if they are not remitted in the time, they are in the problem. If they are remitted in time, no problem. But if they are not remitted within the time, then they are in problem. Simply passing entry. Actually, this is both the entries safe. Internet fee payable to auditor. But in this case, what they did is, what is payable TDS on this amount? They show separately. Actually, they are not deducted. They are not paid the fees also. Where is the question of deduction? They are not paid the fees. But once you pass the TDS payable, department says, you are liable to the department. Therefore, you have deducted 1.5% interest. You have to pay 1.5%
interest.
How does
this
speak to 1%? 1.5%. Sir?
You
are not going to say it. Sir, if they come to your survey.
Near that.
Sir, what I am telling you, you are attracting this 1.5%. Friends, in my one of my assessed case, this amount is coming to 8 lakhs. Because the 0.5% difference is coming to 8 lakhs. 8 lakhs. Because usually all the companies, usually month end or quarterly end or yearly end, half year, they prepare entry, they pass all entries. All payable, contract payment, auditor, all they will pass the entries. Actually, auditor has not done the work, even he has not entered the work, even they are not ready to who is they going to the auditor. Just they pass the entry. Contract payment, agreed, yes. They pass the entries. And they reverse next day. But TDS department said, no, reversal next is not the criteria. You are deducted, you are not remitted, therefore you pay the tax. They said, I am not finding who is going to be auditor. They said, no, you have passed the entries, you deduct. You have deducted, therefore you pay tax. Friends, if you want this example, kindly read the letter share book published by the income tax department. Letter share book, every year in the month of December, they publish one book called letter share. That shows the best assessment done by the in all India level, best TDS survey, best survey, best search assessment, best tribunal order, all these things they will announce. It's called letter share book, published by the income tax department. In 2013 edition or 2014 edition, you see that this example is there. They say the best survey done by the TDS department because this is the unearthed so much interest not paid. Actually, they know interest. Actually, but they say you have passed the interest in this book. Therefore, friends, you should be very careful. If it is only an entry for purpose of your MS report, please delete
TDS.
Please delete, otherwise you are going to be in a problem. Otherwise, remit the taxes to the government.
If you don't pass the entry, the expense
will be
decided
now. Huh? If you don't
pass this entry,
sir, I told you only during the year. Year end, you have to pass the entries, you have to deduct TDS and file the return. What I am telling you, for MS purpose, lot of companies for the quarter ending, half year ending, they pass the entries. To pass the, discuss with the management decision whether what is the profit, they have to provide for it. Understand? But if you not remit the taxes, what are the practical difficulty? Please delete from your books of accounts. Otherwise, you do it outside the books of accounts. Outside the books of accounts. Outside the books means, for the purpose of the MAS calculation, prepare an Excel sheet. Don't pass the entries in the books of accounts. If you pass the entries, these are the consequences you are going to face. This is the problem. You know, up to 31st May, no deduction shall be made from any sum created or paid or like to be created or paid during the previous year to the account of the contractor during the course of business or flying, hiring or leasing goods carrier or furnishing a PAN number to the person paying or creating sum. It means up to 31st May 2015, if the transport contract gives a PAN number, don't deduct it. Any amount, don't deduct it. That is correct. That is the our understanding of this problem. One commissioner in Nagpur, a commissioner TDS, in Nagpur, I think my friend is laughing because he knows that is an issue he has given me. Where he has said that, no, this exemption is available to only a person who is in the business of transport of goods carriage. It means he should be in the business, not available for the other deductor. Take example, a company, I am engaged with VRL, is my transport contractor. A company is paying to VRL, suppose in the year I am making to some 20 lakhs transport payment, and in turn VRL is making a payment to some subcontractor. What Nagpur Commission says that when a company pays to VRL, you should deduct TDS. 194C subclass 6 is not applicable to company because it is applicable to a deductor who is a transport contractor. In this given example, company exemption is not available. This one, you have to deduct TDS. When VRL is making a payment to a subcontractor, VRL can claim this exemption under 194C subclass 6 and not to deduct taxes. That is the interpretation of one commissioner sitting in Nagpur. He issued an instruction to all the commissioner TDS, other areas, saying that you are not doing a good job. I know this is the provision. He has issued. This circular I got out of the ICB. I had a request to meet the CBT chairperson on 13th April 2015. I told him, who is this person to issue clarification to other commissioner? That there is a power to issue such circular. Commissioner cannot give instruction to other commissioner. Only CBDT can clarify. But this fellow, Nagpur commissioner, is given a clarification to other commissioner. You are not doing this wrong interpretation. And he circulated to all the commissioner. Field officer, you are doing wrong. It has come to the knowledge of the Bangalore also. They also started. Oh, Nagpur commissioner is correct. Subsequently, friends, when the 194C subclass 6 amended to recent thing, then they clarified very clearly this exemption is available to anybody, not necessarily a director should be a transport contractor. They made it very clearly now. It means Nagpur commissioner view is wrong, even for earlier period or for the current. They clarified very clearly now, saying that now any director claim exemption provided fulfill the conditions of the transport contractor less than 10 lakh. Now this is the interpretation given by Nagpur commissioner. I think a lot of problems. Finally, now after this finance bill 2015, now I feel that it is settled down very clearly. This exemption is available to any director, not necessarily a transport contractor. This is what the example I want to share with you. Commission under 184H. What is a commission? What is brokerage? Suppose discount, rebate, or incentive given to the buyers. I give it as an incentive. I give it as a discount, I give it as a rebate, whether it is affect 194H. Friends, for application of 194H, you have to see the relationship of these two persons. Whether buyer and seller relationship, where you are selling your goods to somebody, whatever you name call discount or rebate or incentive, 194H is not applicable. But your relationship is a principal and agent relationship. What are the name you call, whether discount or rebate or incentive, 194H is attracted, you have to deduct TDS under 194H at 10%. Okay, that is the thing I want to explain with various case law, but this is one simple. Next is commission paid to a partner on a percentage of export sales, whether TDS to be deducted or not. Here take for example, I am having four partners of a firm X. Out of these two partners are expert in export sales. They have travelled abroad. They have done some export turnover. They have contributed for that. I agreed to pay 2% commission. Whether I deduct TDS or not? No.
Agent or?
You see the agent and relation, there is various, who is the agent, who is the principal?
So
if
the
partner is
acting for the partnership
on
the agent, then yes.
This is also example for letter share books published by the Income Tax Department. I am very clear, TDS is not attracted. But they say no. Under 194A, interest paid to partner, no TDS. But in the 194H, any amount paid to a partner, exemption is not there. Income tax contribution, all these things you see later. But TDS is concerned, you should have deducted under 194H. It is in terms of the partnership deed, whatever that is only a sharing of profit. But they said, no, you have to deduct TDS under 194H. But that is the view of the department. It is announced in the letter share book. Next. Advance rate, somebody asked, rate. In this example, I have paid 8 lakhs for the next 5 financial years on 30th June 2015. Whether TDS to be done or not. 8 lakhs for the 5 years. The 8 divided by 5, it comes to 1.6 lakhs per annum. Whether TDS to be done or not?
No.
No. Why? It is less than threshold. Sir, the circular 715, dated 8th August 1985, it says that when you are making advance rent, if it is more than the threshold limit, you have to deduct TDS, whether it relates to 1 year or 2 years or 10 years, but the total payment advance rent you are making payment in 1 year, if it is more than threshold limit 1.8, you have to deduct. In this case, I am paying 8 lakhs, it is more than threshold limit, but each financial what I am debiting profit loss, it may be 1.6 lakh. You should not see the profit loss account what you are debiting, but what you have paid is important. When your advance rent is paid more than 1.8 lakhs, you have to deduct at the time of payment and debit to the government. In this case, on 8 lakhs you have to deduct in the year of payment. In the subsequent year, deduct you have to claim proportionate rent offered in the year, respective years, and take the TDS credit. That is the requirement. A rent of 5 lakhs paid to 5 co-owners, whether deduct or not. There are 5 co-owners of a commercial complex. I am paying 5 lakhs, 8 lakhs total for the year. The 5 co-owners, whether deduct or not. Yes, sir? No. Yes, sir? 5? No, no, no? Not required. Actually, chartered accountants or any person always very fast in giving the answer without understanding the facts. Why you presume all co-owners are equal? Whether you ask me, sir, 5 owners are equal. Therefore, I told you very clearly, please don't give an answer over the phone. In this example, take for example, A is a 80% co-owner, B is only a 5%, C is a 2%. It is possible. Another is 1%. Sir, each corner share is less than threshold limit, then no TDS. But each corner share is more than 1.8, TDS is there. Therefore, now, this example set to understand that you always, all thought of including me, over the pay, saying that what is the amount? Oh, 8 lakhs divided by 5, 1.6, no TDS. He is also very happy, you are also very happy. But fact is different. Therefore, each corner share is more than 1.8, please. Yeah. Therefore, I told you, all series of questions you have asked as a poor, then you answer. If you are satisfied with his reply, you answer. Otherwise, you tell him, please come to the office, we will discuss. Warehousing charges, whether 184I or 184C? 184I or 184, because you know 184I means 10%, 184C means 1% or 2%. Where was in charge? 184C or 184I? Safer side. There is a circular, where was in charges is 184I. Fine. Cooling charges paid to cold storage plants owners. 184C or 184I? Why C? Why C? Tell me why C?
After paying warehousing charges, we are paying cooling charges.
No, in this case, I'll give you an example. I understand Natraj's anxiety in this. See, in this case, I say, give me this a cold storage plant. I'll say, give the full floor to me. I will use for this year. Whether I store 10 tons or I will not store anything. But give me this. Then what happens, Natraj? Whether 184 or 194. See, this is a cold storage plant. Sir, you have to see the facts of the case. Actually, the circular issued without understanding that. The prominent factor is usage of land or building, 184I. Only factor is, suppose, is the only usage of facilities, 184C. Take for example, in this example, I'll say that I'll store 10 tons. I'll give per 10 basis, then 184C. Because you are not taking the control of the full area. Therefore, friends, what are the circular issued by CBDT? I want to say, please don't go with the circular. Please go by the facts. Understand the facts. The facts, prominent factor is the usage of land, then 184I. If it is a facility, it is 184C.
So it could be 194
I400 usury. Yeah, 194 IA. That is 2%. So whatever rate 194 C may be 1%. Rate difference is the problem. Next is rent paid to a owner on percentage of sales. Whether 194i or 194h or 194c. Suppose take for example hall is there. You will say that don't pay me a rent. You pay me a 1% of the total sales made in a day. Each day what are the sales made, you calculate the exhibition. Number of days you used into 1%, it comes to be suppose 4 lakhs, 5 lakhs, whatever. It is more than 1.8. Then whether you are deducted under 194i or 194h commission.
194i.
Because prominent factor is usage of land. Your percentage of calculation may be, your calculation of rent is based on the sales. But still it is a rent, it is for the is usage of land you are giving or usage of building. Therefore 194i, you have to deduct TDS under 194i.
Shopping malls are coming under that.
Yes, correct. Tenants of a commercial complex. Suppose you are staying in a commercial complex where you are paying to your owner various rent, anyhow 194i, no issues. Maintenance charges, 194i or 194c? Clear? Suppose I give you an example, your rent agreement says you pay me 20,000 per month rent, apart from that you have to pay maintenance charges 5,000, the same agreement it says. You have to pay 5,000 rupees maintenance charge irrespective of the maintenance. Actual maintenance may be different. Maybe 3,000 or maybe 4,000 or maybe 6,000. But you have to pay me 5,000 rupees maintenance charges fixed. And you are paying rent 20,000. Whether it is deducted TDS or 20,000 195, no problem. 5,000 or 194i or 194c. Yes. Because here irrespective of the maintenance, you have to pay lump sum amount. Therefore, my view is 184i. But if it says maintenance charges on actual basis, they say maintenance charges based on the your maintenance part, the security, common area, lighting, all together is actual meter basis, or I say square feet basis, 2 rupees, 1 rupee 50 paisa, like that. Actual means no TDS. If it is less than the threshold, otherwise no. Power water charge also is actual reimbursement. No TDS, because instead of you are paying to KB, your owner collects from you and revenue to government. Therefore, if you have paid directly to this BESCOM or to BWC, you will not deduct TDS, correct? You deduct TDS. No. Therefore, this TDS only actual rate.
If they maintain some margins,
yeah. If you maintain margin, you have to deduct TDS. Yeah, that's why I told you. Actual is different from the what you are paying on a percentage deal. That is different. Therefore, if it is actual, it means what they incurred you are collecting from you, there will not be an issue. Here is a case R purchase a residential property.
Sir,
sir.
The previous example only, if he is collecting on actual basis, then no TDS at all.
Correct. So actual payment, actual basis, the power and water charges and maintenance charges.
No TDS at all.
Because you are supposed to maintain. Instead, on behalf of you is maintained, then you will have to pay.
So there is no question of 194C.
No, no. But you are paying an ad hoc basis. What my friend told is ad hoc basis. Then it will be a 194C. But in the rent agreement, to fix some 5,000 rupees per month, then 194I. You know, different facts.
Please, just sorry, I just clarify one, sir, if you don't mind, sir. One situation is where it's flat rate of 5,000 maintained in the rent agreement, then it is 194I.
Yeah.
If it is collected on actual basis, no TDS whatsoever. And if it is collected on ad hoc basis monthly, if I tell him, I say on a phone call, I tell him this month 3,000, next month 4,000, next month 5,000, even if there's some margin involved, then it is 194C.
See, correct. Here is a pair, R purchased a residential property from a non-resident for 20 crores. Sale was concluded by initiation on 1st January 2013. Mr. R received a notice from the Income Tax Department stating that R violated the provision of 195. Tell me whether he is violated or not. Is R purchased a residential property from a non-resident for 20 crores. Sale is registered. In sale deed, NR non-resident address is residing at Bangalore so and so. He has given PAN number. Everything is mentioned. But he is a non-resident. That fact is not available of the by the purchaser. But whether 195 violation or no violation. Violated, na? But how you ensure that it is a non-resident wherever non-resident is, how will you ensure that you will not violate the provision? But he has given the same deity saying that I am a resident of Bangalore, so-and-so, Jainagar. He has taken oath before the sub-registrar. Correct? He has taken oath before the sub-registrar I am residing at. He has given a PAN number. I have not suspected that he is a non-resident. But I come to know only when I receive notice from the income tax department, he is a non-resident. But you have violated the provision. Therefore, you are liable for all the consequences of non-deduction, interest, penalty, all these things will attract. All this will attract because you are not cautioned when you are buying. Therefore, now my suggestion is, whenever you are buying, you are in anxiety of buying a property, you should be very careful whether you are buying from a non-resident. Whether you take affidavit from him, you have to take an affidavit from saying that you have to see the passport. Or if you are aware of he is a buyer, he is, sorry, seller is, you know very well, he is certainly here, you have seen him very familiar, no problem. If he is an unknown person, he is a stranger to you, please enquire all these things, whether you are non-resident. You are a, where, how many years you are here. And if you take xerox copy of the passport, see that everything is alright. If he is a resident, no issues. Only 194, IA, 1% you have to get TDS, this is more than 50,000, 50 lakh. But if non-resident, no threshold limit. Even if buy a 1 lakh property, you have to get TDS. 195 is very clear, rate is 20%. 194 IA, 1%. But if non-resident, it is higher rate and no threshold limit. You have to deduct at even whatever 1 lakh or 10 lakhs, you have to deduct TDS. Yes, sir.
Sir, what happens right now, the co-owner is non-resident?
Then to the extent of his portion, you have to deduct it. His consideration is very clearly mentioned. What you are paying to non-resident is so much amount, on that amount you have to deduct it. Resident payment only 194A. There are two provisions. 194A, if it is more than 50 lakh, you have to deduct at 1%. If it is a non-resident, no threshold limit, whatever amount you pay, deduct at 20%. Provided is at a PAN, all is required, subject to all the
Okay? You got an instance where the non-resident was selling a property. And his cost of purchase also was known. And then there was capital gain was
very minimal.
And
sir, as a buyer, you are not bothered about his competition at all.
So, but you, sir, TDS has to be done only if the income is chargeable to tax.
Correct, sir. How you know income is not chargeable to tax?
I have the TDS.
No, only assessing officer has to give you certify that. You don't have a power to certify yourself and check that he is not liable. No, you have to go AO, buyer or seller, you have to go to AO, assessing officer, make an application saying that these are all the facts. Let him give a certificate saying that deduct at nil rate, deduct at 1%, deduct at 0%, deduct at 10%, whatever rate he says, that rate you have. Otherwise, as a buyer or a seller, you don't have a self certification.
So, in fact, I got a certificate from the.
No, what I'm telling is, as a buyer, you have to deduct. If you don't want to deduct or you want to help the seller, please ask him to make an application or you make an application on the behalf and get it.
I got the certificate. But later, after I attended one more study circle meeting like this, where another gentleman was addressing all 185. Then I asked the same question. His personal opinion was that there was no need to deduct this.
Sir, in the case of, take for example, I know the contractor is incurring loss every year. I am making 1 crore payment to him. And at 194C, I can say no, not because he is incurring huge loss. Why are
you?
Sir, why you are, no, why you are changing it?
No, this 195 says only your income chargeable tax.
Sir, how you know income is not chargeable tax? You are assessing officer.
No, I get the information. I get the information from you.
Sir, your information is bogus. How you know your information is correct? Therefore, the law provides you under 194A, sorry, 195, subclause 2, you have to go to the AO. That's why they provided for. The person who has told you, you have to ask him. Why you told, how can you come to such conclusion? Income chargeable to tax means your sale condition is not chargeable, is chargeable to tax. Definitely is chargeable to tax. What is the component to be chargeable tax is a question to be decided by AO. Whether it may be a loss also. If you index it, it is loss. Then you cannot give all the benefit. I think the buyer is don't have a choice. You have to go to AO and get the. No, don't take a decision then.
International
action. Sir? Yeah, international action you have to take. Here is R purchased the property from NR, non-resident, for 24, same example, and deduct tax resources under 185. Tax was remitted to through a company's TAN numbers. He is a director of a company, he didn't have a TAN number, But taking a TAN number takes time. He decided, okay, I'll give a check to company. Please take company, remit it. That's how only use the TAN number of a company to remit the tax. Now the department says, no, you're not deducted, you're not remitted. Company has deducted, remitted. You have violated all the provisions. Therefore, you are liable for all the consequences. Friends, here is a case where I deducted, remitted. Only thing is, I didn't have a TAN number, practical problem. I don't know what is wrong in that. Use a company TAN number, I give a check to company, company remitted or something. They say, no. This is the live example of Bangalore Circle. In Bangalore, this is the case where we are fighting. It's a technical default. I remitted. Company gives a declaration saying that I received white check number so and so, so much amount, and remitted as per the instruction of managing director of the company. Therefore, now the amended 195 sub clause 6, they amended where they said that now onwards, 1st June 2015 onwards, no TAN number is required in case of a non-resident payments. They have to make a 194i. But they want to prescribe procedure. So far, they are not prescribed. 1st June 2015, they should have prescribed by this time. I saw that there is no, they are not prescribed any chalan number. Procedure of payment, they are not prescribed, but they should prescribe. Otherwise, they are very difficult because obtaining a TAN number of individual for only purpose of remitting, like 194i say that no TAN is required, you remit through a PAN number, it is fine. They have to prescribe that procedure, but they are not prescribed. So, friends, finally I will come to the controversies. I will take, I think, Arvind, how much time, sir? Another 20 minutes? 5 minutes?
6 minutes.
Sorry. The controversy and the TDS provisions. Deductor one side, department is another side. If you say no TDS, department say yes TDS. The transaction is very clear, no TDS is required under any provisions, but department says yes, you have to deduct TDS. But if you deduct under 194C, department say you have to deduct under 194J. Because under 194C is 2%, in 194J 10%, they will say always more. If you deduct under 194, they say 194i. Under 194c, you deduct, they say 194h. If you deduct under 194j, 10%, they say under 192. Take for example, a doctor working for a hospital. Suppose particular doctor visits for a particular time of Sagar Apollo Hospital, next he visits another hospital, Columbia, and after that another hospital, he visits all. The department says, the hospital is paying a salary to the all these consultant, you have to deduct TDS under 192 because you know the, what they are getting is more than 10-15 lakhs per year because they corrupted 30%. They say 192 is not corrupted. But the hospital has deducted 10% because professional charges, they are not employed. But this is also reported in Lettershare book where they said that St. John Hospital, this is a Bangalore case, where they said that you should deduct under 192. But finally, tribunal held that No, 194J is correct.
No, sir, there's a problem there. The doctors are under the rolls and also doing a consultation in the evening.
Then I think 192. But the Lettershare book, what they publish it, they are not given that. What they say is, if I am only coming as a consultant every day, I am coming as every day as a consultant, I am not the rolls of the hospital, then my view is correct.
Just correct, but what fact was happened is they were in the salary rolls, they were a deductor for the salary that they got 192. Then what happened? Their consultant, specialist, the cardiologist, and all, for the that fee they deducted 10%. The department went and made reassessment and saying that you have to pay 192 and made they paid also 6 crores they paid.
But in the tribunal they got the relief, you should be 194.
They paid the penalty.
But what I'm telling you is, I am only a consultant, not the employee of a hospital. My example is where I am a consultant, I go only at a particular time, visit and give a consultancy. What I collect from the patient, what I collect through the hospital, is my consulting charge. Therefore, it should be 194 change, not 194. If you take for one step further, I say no TDS at all. No TDS, because there is an exemption under 194 change. It says that when an individual make the payment to a consultant, on a personal capacity. All patients come on a personal, they come for their disease, not for the company's disease. Then what happened? They pay through hospital. Hospital is only a coordinator. Therefore, in my opinion, whatever the patients pay through through hospital, 184J also is not attracted.
But hospitals add no margins.
That margin
pass through entity.
Sir, what happened? They collect. No, I give example.
No,
I'll say.
There's a decision of High Court. No, Karnataka High Court decision is there.
I tell you, sir. Suppose take for example, I collect 100 rupees, out of which I'll retain 20 rupees, and 8 rupees I have paid to the doctor. This is K. For each patient, is like this. What 80 rupees I pay, it is only I collect and give 80 rupees to doctor. I retain my service charges 20 rupees. Therefore, what paid by the patient is 100 rupees. Out of which 20 goes to hospital and 80 goes to doctor. Therefore, is individual made the payment. Not the hospital is not paid. Number of patients visited into 80 rupees is making payment. Therefore, it is a payment to individual.
There is no privacy of contract between patients and the doctors. Doctors are not called by the patients.
Sir, I go to the hospital because he is a good cardiologist. Because ascertain from all the my friends. Well, who is a good cardiologist in the hospital? And I'll go to
and there is no contract between hospital and patient also.
Patient also. See, what I am telling is, I will go to a particular hospital because seeing the doctor, not hospital's corporate structure and other thing. I will go to a hospital, I will go to Columbia because a good doctor is there. Not because Columbia Hospital is a good hospital. I will go because a good doctor is there. Therefore, I feel that that is the correct argument. Anyway, this is the thing.
Sir, the process here, 20 rupees go to the hospital, is it a rent or is it a commission?
It is administrative charge. It is an admission charge. You can portion, it is an admission. You cannot bifurcate how much towards rent. It is an admission charge because some staff also assisting, making apartment, noting down your all this thing. Therefore, it is an admission charge. Therefore, you cannot call this rent. It is not a rent. Next is 192, department say 190. Take for example, pygmy agents of a bank, they collect commission from the all the depositors and give to the bank. They get some 5%, 10%, whatever the commission. That is always we say, under circular law issued by the CBDT, it is a salary. You have to deduct TDS under 192. There is a circular in 2008, 2011. There are two circulars. All pygmy agent, RD agents, you have to deduct TDS under 192. But department 194H. Because 192 meant up to 2.5 lakhs, no TDS. 194H means more than 5,000 deducted 10%. They get more. It means that our controversy with the department is always like that. They want to collect more tax from you. That is their objective, is collect more tax from you. Friends, I want to conclude with the thanks to all of you. Duty and responsibility under Chapter 17B cannot be bypassed by the director to anybody. You have to do it here. You only have to discharge the responsibility. Method of accounting. Friends, under Section 145, with effect from 1st April 1997, very clear, any person who is competing income under their business and profession or other sources, you have to follow consistently market-type basis or cash basis report. There's only two methods. But after introduction of 40A, 1A, after introduction of 40A, 1A, your method of accounting is no relevance at all. If you deduct and remit to the government, then only you are entitled for deduction. Correct? Suppose auditor fee, 1 lakh you have provided in books. If you are not deducted TDS, 1 lakh will not be allowed because whether you follow cash basis reporting or market type basis. Therefore, after introduction of 40A, 1A, compliance basis is overtakes the your method of accounting.
Sir, if you file 26A form number, then it is allowed anyway.
Huh?
If you file the form number 26, that is the person who is receiving the amount he has included in his income statement and the
credit. That is correct, sir. That is all procedure to follow. What I'm doing on the
base of it,
you should prove that you are compliant with the provisions. Sir, if you have a 1,000 contractor or 1,000 professionals for which you are not deducted, you have to collect 1,026A. When you collect, practically it's very difficult. Very easy to say. I'll say as a consultant, 26A collect, file it over. When you have to file? At a time of assessment? Or after filing, doing tax audit, you have to obtain 26A. This is very different. Anyway, compliance basis overtakes the your method of accounting. 40A, 1A overtakes Section 145 of the Income Tax Act. Compliance is very important. Next is, friends, golden principles under Chapter 17B, when you are dealing with the TDS provisions, have some golden principles. You have to keep it in there. For this purpose, you have to ignore whatever I said so far. Erase from your memory whatever I said so far, then you can understand the golden principles. Dwarkanath, I'll finish my present after that you answer. Opportunity of TDS. There is a two views on transaction. I say it is applicable. Shetty says it is not applicable. My golden principle says that take the view in favor of applicability of TDS. Don't take a view in favor of the not applicable TDS. You always in favor of deducting tax of source. Next is you have a rate problem. 194C means 2% or 1%. 194J means 10%. Take for example a chartered accountant deputed his assistants to client place for reconciliation of bank or a debt transfer reconciliation. There is no question of any given report. I charge per assistant per month 20,000. He gives 1 lakh. Per number of assistant deputed, he gives 1 lakh. Whether deduct TDS under 194J or 194C. Because no professional work. I am not giving any report. As a chartered accountant, as a consultant, I deputed 5 assistants for deputing for reconciling debtor account or the bank reconciliation. It's not a professional work. Assisting the accountant.
194J.
Now, that is a view, whether 194J or 194C. Okay. My golden principle says that take a view in favor of higher rate of TDS. In this case, 194J 10%. Take the view in favor of 194J. Next is deduct and remit. Don't wait for the last minute 7. Deduct and remit on the same day. Why you want to wait for the no bar that if you have to remit only on the 7th of September? You can remit, deduct every day, deduct every, remit every day. There is no question of waiting for next month. Last very important means planning. Friends, don't make any arrangement or a planning to avoid TDS problem. What is the benefit you get? As a director, what benefit you get? A classic example is, one person comes, sir, I am giving rent for a commercial complex, the 3 floors, I am getting total is around 6-7 lakhs. Then immediately, sir, TDS is attracted. You say, usual TDS is attracted, you have to deduct 10%. And you have to claim refund from the department if it is or you are. No, sir. What would be is ground floor for me, first floor for my wife, daughter, and son. Everybody will be owners of this. Actually, they are not contributed, they are not owners legally. Purpose of TDS, they divide the rental. Please, friends, don't advise such planning to avoid TDS. That is not advisable. Because you are not saving any as a director, you are getting anything. No. Therefore, don't plan or arrangement to avoid TDS. Finally, I want to come to the how to read the TDS provisions. Friends, you have two types of clients. One client, he comes in well in advance, says that, sir, I want to go for a JD, I want to construct an apartment, and he says, you then come to you advise what are the provisions. You have to deduct TDS under 194C, you have to deduct TDS under 194, you will advise on. One set of clients who comes well in advance, what are the transactions they have to, they will come and consult you, whether TDS or any other VAT, all this is there. That is one type of client. For them is, you have to read, until you are clear about the provisions and rules. This first of paper who comes in advance, you read only sections, read only rules, and read circulars and notifications. Then, you advise accordingly. A person who comes well in advance, you read only rules and sections and notification and circulars. Don't read anything. But you have another set of people who comes only with year end. Correct? At the time of tax audit they come, they have violated everything. All provisions they have violated. They come on the last minute. Then, for them is, you have to read the case laws of the Supreme Court, High Court and Tribunals. Then you see whether any case law come to risk you saying that this type of transaction, no TDS, or this rate you have to deduct. Then you have to advise accordingly. Friends, you have to read September 3 and 4 only for the persons who have comes on the last minute after default. For the step number 1 and 2, persons who come well in advance. One more step he has left by my assistant who has prepared this slide. Collect the fees accordingly. Anyway, friends, I continue my this one. Friends, always any issue comes before you as a chartered accountant, as a consultant, out of my 32 years of experience, first apply your common sense first. Don't go to case law. First read the, apply your general law, apply your common sense. Think 5 minutes, then come to basic law. What, which section is applicable? section 182 or 184C or 184. Go to the section. Then you read the case law. What do you usually do? Read the case law. As per the case law, this is not applicable. As per the case law, this is the right. That is a wrong. Always, because a lot of youngsters is that, please don't go to case law and corrupt your mind. Please read the, apply your common sense first, then read the basic law, income tax, whichever section, read 10 times. Then you read the case law. If you read the case law first, your mind is correct, you will not at all apply your mind. Because you go always, so-and-so case law, sir, says so. In my office also, whenever I say the issue, they come with the case law. I told, no, please tell me as per the income tax provision, whether I am entitled for or not. Then you tell me case law. So first apply your common sense, apply the basic law, then apply the case law. Don't, reverse is not permissible for youngsters. Only for persons like us, you can go for the case law. Anyway. Friends, I want to thank the organizers, and also in the first meeting of the new committee, it is also a pleasure for me to address all of you. Deduct and remit without failure. Deduct and remit without failure. Avoid interest under 2011A, penalty under 271H, prosecution under 276B, disallowance under 41A with due care. File TDS returns 24Q and 26Q, issue form number 16 and 16A within the prescribed time. Friends, if you do all these things, I think no seminar is required, no workshop is required on TDS, because you are following all these things. Then, if you do all these things, deductor, deductee, and income tax department will smile forever. With this, I thank the organizers and all of you for the patient hearing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, CA R Venkatesh, for the crisp presentation where you tried to demystify several critical and complex issues pertaining to TDS in a very simple manner. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, to CA R Venkatesh. And I now request CA George to kindly present a small memento to the session speaker as a token of our appreciation.
Thank you, sir.
Sir.
Thank you, sir. Just one announcement. In case any of the members have any kind of suggestions or advice to the new managing committee, you are requested to send an email to plrchairman@icai.org. And all the managing committee members, whenever you meet them in the institute, all of us are open to taking suggestions. Please do give your advice so that we can serve you better. On this note, we conclude today. Good night.